Generic YouTuber intro, you know what we're doing now. We forgot to drink in the last two, but let's correct that today. Brad, what have I got? What did you find for me in the office to open this up with?
I mean, you've not got a lot in here, but there's some hair gel.
Oh, sweet. Yeah, what a catch. Let's roll. So Brad, as per usual, would you like to explain the premise of today's video for the lovely folks at home?
Yeah, we were trying to think of something we could do, and Carl eyed a book he had on his cabinet.
Yes, because if people don't know, I like to collect dumb books containing dumb things, in addition to like research books, which I use for videos.
And this dumb book appears to be, what is it, Blunders?
It's called The World's Greatest Blunders, and it is a collection of news of the weird type stories found in British newspapers that someone has collated and put into book form. And I've gone through briefly and just highlighted a few dumb stories that me and Brad are gonna go through and like offer our reactions to. So thought, fact thing focus, we can focus on anything.
And I specifically said to Carl, do not read these out to me before we start, because I want to come in fresh.
The thing is, you can tell as well that I wasn't very organized in uni for a start, can't you? Because look at how fucking bad these like marks are. I just put bollocks to it. Do you want to start with a story that actually made me laugh? And this is called Bloomers in Briefs, the section. It's just brief stories. Like, do you know when you're reading the Daily Mail or some shit like that because, like, you know, you've run out of toilet paper and you want something to do while you sat on it. And you go, oh, these are the dumb stories they track down as, like, you know, space filler. It's those stories. Let's go start with one that I think, you know, just encapsulates British culture. A top store aimed a sales promotion at their account customers, which included Prince Charles. He received a missive addressed by computer to Mr. HRH Prince Charles at Buckingham Palace, the Mall. The letter from the impertinent machine began, "Dear Mr. Prince, what would your neighbours in the Mall think if you pulled up outside Charles Buckingham Palace in a brand new red Ford Fiesta, complete with sunroof and alloy wheels?" Think about that. We should point out, British tabloids especially don't have a sterling reputation for, like, you know, verifying claims that says, so take everything we're about to discuss with a grain of salt. But I'd like to believe that's real because it's so stupid. It's clear, like, Prince Charles must be on mailing list somewhere. He must shop somewhere.
I really hope that the royal family have email addresses and get spammed just like we do.
They do, don't they? It's like, there's a story that happened recently, not recently, but more recently than this, because this book's from fucking like 10 years ago. And, like, the Queen set up an official Twitter account, and the first comment she got was just someone said, abdicate. What a fucking story is that, though? Just, hey, Prince Charles, how would you like a new red Ford Fiesta? It's one of those emails that's, like, generated by the computer. So have you ever seen, like, some of the ones that people have gotten when they put their name wrong and they get it sent by, like, the random computers? Have you ever, when you're filling out, like, a form online, where it asks you to put your address in, just put a fake name? Like, I put, like Lance Manhammer once, and I just got a message, like, some spam mail directed to Mr. Lance Manhammer. You ready to move on to a new story? We've got one here. A canal boat scene for an Andrex toilet tissue advert took almost a year to shoot because of the unpredictable British weather. Typical. For the next commercial, which showed a family sitting on the lawn on a summer's day with the famous puppy romping around them, the ad agency decided, fuck this, not taking no chances, let's go to California to find the perfect sunny English garden. But sadly, it rained solidly the entire time. They had to plant 200 fake daffodils and use floodlights for sunshine.
But if they're going to put that much effort into fly everyone over to California, just build a garden indoors.
That's what they ended up doing, using fucking floodlights for the thing. There's nothing better than British weather, is there? Like, British weather is so unpredictable. But you know what? We don't have tornadoes and earthquakes. So I think it's okay.
I've been here long enough now that I can step out the door, take a deep breath and go, it's going to rain in 10 minutes.
But are your favourite headlines, like, local newspapers are the best for this. They are a boon for stories. Like, whenever you have strong wind and you'll see, like, oh, roof damaged by strong wind, it's like three tiles fell off or some shit like that.
The worst gales we had back in Cumbria, it got to the point where, like, it was blowing drain pipes off houses and everyone's like, the panic. Like, there are places in the US where they get tornadoes and they're just like,
the house just gets coming. Obliterated.
Yeah, just go underground, guys. There's a tornado coming. Just sit it out.
I can top this one because I lived in a house once that wasn't great. And one time, we were just sat there in the house and we heard this God almighty crash. And we went into our, like, you know, our housemate's room who was out. And her window had blown away because it was that windy. But she'd left a window open. It slammed open and the window had blown off down the road somewhere. And at that point, like, we're wondering, like, what do you do? Because obviously the wind is now just filtering directly into a room, whipping everything around in a tornado. It looked like that's, you know, that scene in Paranormal Activity, where everything explodes out of the cupboards. Imagine that times 10. All her work's on her desk. So we had to text our landlord saying, no, we're really sorry, but the window was blown away. What do we do?
How did the conversation go when she got back?
We just texted her saying, I'm sorry, but your window's blown away. It's like, what? Actually, no, we didn't text her first. We actually posted it on Facebook first, and she found out that way. Next one we've got here, and this is a personal favourite of mine, because I recalled it, because I read this book a few times, and I recalled the story. It's like, a tea company landed in hot water. Oh, there's that, there's that British pun writing you'd expect from our newspapers. With a competition designed to boost their tea bag sales, it succeeded beyond their wildest dreams when syndicates devised a way of winning £20 on every box of 160 bags and bought them by the lorry load. The 100-strong London group stood to collect £80,000 for an outlay of £8,600 on 4,000 boxes weighing 8 tonnes. And you're probably thinking, what happened here? Well, their leader explained, you have to scratch off the cards to reveal 6 hidden teacups. And we thought, the cards must be quite expensive to print. So we reckoned that if we scraped off enough cards, we would end up with a key to every diagram in circulation. After that, every card would be a winner. So what they did is they realised, well, the card, there's only so many combinations, so scrap by like 500, scratch them off until you have like every single possible permutation of like teacups, and then you know where to start scratching to make every single one a winner. There was just one snag though, because the tea company was prepared to pay out, but its insurers refused, on the grounds that the syndicate competitors had broken the rules by not using, and I quote, their skill and judgment.
In scratching something.
No, I'd say they used both of those things, wouldn't you? Skill and judgment. Oh yeah, we figured out how to win every time. If that's not skill, I don't know what the fuck is. And there's nothing that annoys me more than these stories you hear about companies weaseling out of paying people fucking money that they earned rightfully, because they didn't think, or they didn't close all the loopholes. There's nothing wrong with exploiting a loophole, especially when said loophole means a massive business loses money. Fuck them. So I've done a few articles about this, like today I found out the famous one is the pudding swindle. Have you heard about this?
I don't think so.
The pudding swindle was a guy who got air miles, basically, which is like travel if you have so many of them. And he was, a company was offering like triple air miles on every dollar of product sold or something like that. And he figured that the cheapest possible product he could buy was this specific brand of pudding. And he said, if I get for every like $4 I spend on this pudding, I get like 18,000 air miles. So if I spend $3,000, I can fly free forever. So what he did is he went to every shop in his local area and bought all this pudding, paid people to peel off all the labels and give him the codes, and then donated it all to a charity to write off the amount he'd spent on his taxes, and got like 16 million air miles. And he's travelled first class for free for like that last 10 years. Oh, are you ready for another one?
I'm ready, yeah.
Okay, right. Lincolnshire businessman Oscar Ejimeke's mistake was to mount a nocturnal expedition to poison moles who were digging up his lawn. He decided to use the headlights of his Jaguar to light the scene for his night assault. When the lights dimmed, he started the engine to charge the battery. Without warning, the automatic car shot backwards and crashed through the wall of his house into the sitting room, damaging the Jaguar's petrol tank and dislodging a wall-mounted electric heater. Sparks from the heater ignited the leaking fuel and the car burst into flames. The room was wrecked, the Jaguar gutted, and Oscar's wife Lindy had to flee from the house in her nightclothes. He spent the next day explaining the £6,000 mistake to the insurance company while the moles carried on undisturbed. So it's just, that is, that's like an episode of a sitcom, isn't it? Some mothers would have him that. That's a level of incompetence displayed. Kill some moles. Okay, I'm just going to put like my fucking car headlights on. So there's stories about, have you ever heard the ones about like people burning down their houses because they leave on like hair dryers overnight? I think there's a guy with like a fancy car, he spit, like his kid spilled Coca-Cola on the back seat or something. So I'll dry the seat off with a hair dryer and I'll leave it on overnight. Comes back in the morning, his car's just a burning wreck. So you fucking idiot. Right, you ready for more?
Okay.
An elderly woman was spotted in the loo of a West Country motorway service station trying to dry her hands on the machine next to the wash basin. But no matter how she pushed or pulled the knob, the contraption refused to blow out hot air. The lady was later quoted as saying, "Them's art for drying hands," in a complaint to the service station, to which a service station representative responded, "You're right. Them's our condom dispensers."
I saw that coming.
Just like, think about walking into a service, you see an old woman just beating the shit out of a condom. Like, because you wouldn't realise that she's trying to dry her hands, would you? All you'd see is this old woman aggressively trying to get a condom. In your head, if you saw that, you'd have nothing but respect for that old woman, would you? Like, she stood there, just banging the crap out of her. She needs a condo. Like,
she's banging the crap out of the machine because she's going to bang the crap out of someone else.
So we don't know. Probably the service station manager. Right, ready for another one?
Okay.
Right, a French doctor driving home from Paris on holiday heard an SOS on his car radio and realised that it was his wife who he'd left at a garage 200 miles back. He hadn't realised she'd gone to the toilet when he stopped 3 hours earlier. When later asked to explain how he'd lost his wife, the man explained, "I didn't miss her because we don't talk much while travelling." Right, you ready for another one? Right, Sir Thomas Beecham felt satisfied but exhausted after conducting the Halle Orchestra in a triumphant performance in Manchester in 1939. He was eager to go get to bed after the concert, but felt he should linger a little and do a bit of mingling for the sake of politeness and to greet a woman in the hotel foyer whose face seemed familiar, but whose name he could not for the life of him recall. They exchanged a few pleasantries, and Sir Thomas was about to continue on his way when something jogged his memory. "And tell me, how is your dear brother?" Sir Thomas inquired hopefully. "Oh, he's very well, thank you, Sir Thomas," came the polite reply. "And what's his business now?" replied Sir Thomas. "Oh, well, you know, he's still king." And that is true. I have got an article on that on the website somewhere. And that guy was so fucking embarrassed. Like, he almost had to leave the country of how embarrassing it was. He didn't recognise, like, the sister of the king. This is a slightly longer one called On the Cards. Fate really put the boot in for the Wellington family. Fucking British newspapers are so good at puns. They're just all right as well. They're open with a pun. They won £100,000 in a football draw, but lost the prize-winning tickets. John, Sally, and their son Mark could have kicked themselves when they realised they had misunderstood the rules. Mark had been given a winning ticket showing a picture of Liverpool star Ian Rush when he filled up with petrol at a garage taking part in the football game. To stand a chance of winning a fortune, Mark had to match his card up with another showing Liverpool's club motif, and they had actually had the winning card in their home in Harrogate, Cinderford, Gloucestershire. But the Wellingtons all thought they had to have two pictures on one card to win, so they threw both cards out. 3 days later, after a search of their local tip with a special permission from the council, failed to produce the cards and cost them a chance of scoring £100,000. Again, another fucking solid pun in there. The Wellingtons could only stare bleakly as all the rubbish was finally bulldozed into the ground. "It was heartbreaking," said Mrs. Wellington. "I tremble when I put those cards in a rubbish bag. Matters were even worse for her husband, John, when his colleagues at work couldn't understand how a financial manager could have thrown away the chance at making a fortune." I had a similar story once when, do you remember the Bertie Bassett promotion, where if you found a Bertie Bassett in your sweet packet, you won £1,000? My mum, I think, got one of them and ate it, not realising.
There was the most recent one I saw was the cream egg one, and it was if you find a white cream egg, you can win all this money.
Okay.
And I went to buy a cream egg just because I wanted a cream egg, and everyone had scratches. People have been going through and taking the
just
service off.
Just scratching a little bit of the foil off to find a white one. This is the last one that I've got marked down, okay. So it's going to be a good one. Under the Hammer. Butcher Arthur Dawson, no fucking pun for that one I see, thought he got a good price in the rusty old banger. Damn it!
Is that British slang for a banger?
For Americans, banger is...
a sausage.
Yeah, it means sausage. He sold the old banger, which stood in his garage in Warsaw for 30 years. So he sold it to a dealer in Warsaw for £150,000. So a kindly car dealer who didn't seem to mind about the bodywork falling apart and the mice attacking the leather upholstery. In fact, the rusty old banger turned out to be a 1936 Mercedes-Benz Tourer, a classic model of car of which 10 were made and only 4 still exist. The kindly car dealer had been John Price, who put his new purchase up for auction where it sold for £1.5 million. The new proud owner, millionaire Swedish property developer Hans Thulin, had spent the last 10 years scouring the world for the 500k Mercedes-Benz special roadster. "I'll restore it, and very soon it'll be worth £5 million, he said, "but I'll never sell it." All Mr. Dawson could say when asked for comment was, "I didn't do a very good deal, did I?" Which I think...
That's so British.
That is the most British fucking sentence ever uttered. It's like, you missed out on earning millions of pounds. Didn't get a very fucking good deal then, did I? And then just went about his day. I love that shit. And this was an idea we just threw together in 5 minutes, if people couldn't tell. So if people like this one, because this is specifically something we didn't know would work as a focus, but I had fun. I've had a fucking laugh, I've had a beer, I'm having a good day. So let us know and we'll do more of these in future maybe.